is Troy Littleton. I'm a professor in the Picaro Institute for Learning and Memory in the Department of Biology at MIT. My lab studies synapses, which are the sites that neurons connect together in the brain. And we're interested in how these structures form, how they work, and how they can undergo plasticity within the nervous system. And as many of you know, synapses are the site for many neurological diseases, things like autism, intellectual disability, some of the late onset neurodegenerative disorders, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, Huntington's disease, all have defects that arise primarily from defects in synaptic communication or the death of synapses as one ages. And so my lab uses the fruit fly Drosophila as a model system to really understand how these structures within the nervous system are built and how they work. I became interested in synapses during my MD PhD work when I trained at Baylor College of Medicine with Hugo Bellin. And in Hugo's lab, I studied how the basic aspects of synaptic communication occur. How is it that one neuron can talk to another neuron? And it was there that I was introduced to the fruit fly as a model system. And Drosophila, although far removed from humans in terms of brain anatomy, the core mechanism by which neurons work in the fly and in humans is highly conserved. So the basics of how two neurons have talked to each other emerge very early in evolution. And those core principles are highly stereotypical between human neurons and mammalian neurons all the way down to fly neurons. And so by understanding how these basic properties of synapses work, we can understand how diseases actually affect their properties and diseases that actually affect humans. And so many of the types of things that my lab is interested in focus around several neurological diseases. We're interested in autism, which is a neurodevelopmental disorder. Autism genetics has revealed a host of gene products that can cause this syndrome in children, and many of those gene products actually affect the synapse. And so we have been modeling some of these autism disease genes in the fruit fly model to try to understand how is it that the wiring of the nervous system early in development or the function of the nervous system is actually affected in these autism disease mutants. We also study epilepsy. So epilepsy is a disorder where neurons hypersynchronously fire and they generate aberrant patterns that lead to seizures in humans. And the fruit fly is a very good model for studying epilepsy. It has well-connected neurons where ion channels and other gene products control local circuit activity. And we have identified a number of gene products in the fruit fly that can cause epilepsy. And part of that work has sort of led to an emerging view that not only are neurons critical for excitability phenomenons in the fruit fly, but the other brain cell type, glia, also participate in epilepsy. And we've recently identified manipulations that we can make in glial cells that influence neurons and cause them to be hyperexcitable. So this has us very excited about potential new therapeutics for epilepsy as well, and that we might be able to target glial cells to reduce the pathology associated with epilepsy instead of the neurons themselves. Because targeting the neurons themselves, which is very common in epilepsy, has many different side effects. So that's an area of research that we're very interested in as well. The other principal area that we're sort of studying in the lab and sort of the main focus of my lab is really on synaptic communication. How is it that one neuron can excite another neuron through the release of neurotransmitters? So neurotransmitters like dopamine and serotonin, acetylcholine, GABA, glutamate are released throughout the brain to excite or inhibit their partners. And there's a molecular set of machines that control the release of these neurotransmitters. And we've been studying that in detail in the lab. And our recent work is really focused on a set of proteins called the synaptotagmins, which bind calcium during an action potential and then drive the fusion of synaptic vesicles to release neurotransmitters. And we recently, together with some clinical collaborators, found groups of patients that have defects in these synaptotagmin molecules that apparently control synaptic biology. And so by using a fruit fly as a model system, we can begin to understand how these mutations that are found in humans disrupt the function of this synaptotagmin family of proteins and begin to think about ways that we might sort of approach therapeutics for that as well. So those are some of the things that my lab is engaged in, sort of trying to link how neurons talk to each other and the core biology of synapses with a host of neurological diseases, as well as plasticity mechanisms that the brain can use to both build a normal nervous system and have that nervous system mediate behavioral responses that are appropriate to the environmental stimuli that we have.